Welcome. In the previous clip, we started looking at how rocks deform in the low temperature regime. We've seen that the first 5 to 10% of length changes are generally accommodated by a large number of structures, joints and/or stylolites distributed over the entire body, absorbing little overall strain. With increasing strain, the rock must adopt different ways to accommodate deformation and will develop mechanic instabilities. These are faults and folds. Today, we focus on faults. Faults are zones of high deformation which accommodate substantial displacement. Faults are features of great importance in geology. Faults can be active at present and, like in the case shown, even displace riverbeds. These faults are often associated with earthquakes. Faults are also of crucial importance in fluid flow. Most of the hot waters feeding thermal baths move upward along faults. Depending on the relative sense of movement of one block with respect to the other, we can distinguish three types of faults. Normal faults, when the upper block slides down with respect to the lower block, causing an increase in horizontal length. Reverse faults of thrusts, when the upper block slides upward with respect to the lower block, causing horizontal shortening. Strike slip, when the two blocks move laterally with respect to each other. Strike slip faults are often subvertical and can be sinistral or dextral. Quantifying movements across faults is of great importance. During deformation, the body will become longer, as in the case shown, or shorter. The difference between the initial and the final length is called extension or contraction, respectively. If you normalize this number by the initial length, you obtain a parameter called strain. If information is available on the duration of faulting, one can obtain the rate of deformation. Many geological phenomena depend on how fast deformation occurs. Connecting two points which were in contact before deformation, a displacement vector is defined. The displacement vector can be split in a horizontal and a vertical component. Faults are not always planar and can be curved. In the case of normal faults, layers in the upper block become steeper towards the fault and form a rollover anticline. If sediments are deposited during deformation, they will record a progressive change in position. In the reverse fault case, the upper block moves upward and forms also a fold called ramp fold. Because of the curved shape of the faults, the upper block develops particular geometries and structures which are not present in the much more regular and simple planar faults. Faults rarely come alone and form rather fault system. Normal faults appear often in pairs with opposing dips, form a systematic angle of 60 degrees, defining Horst and Grabens. Alternatively, normal faults can have all the same dip direction and form a so-called bookshelf assemblage. In the third variation, faults develop on the hanging wall of a fault block gliding downwards along a major lithic fault. These are called antithetic faults. Association of shortening faults and the related faults are typical for the external zones of mountain belts forming fold and thrust belts. We will see more of this when discussing the formation of mountains. Until now, we have looked at faults as if they were simple geometric features. This is obviously not the case. Along faults, you might find thick packages of broken rocks or layers of shales. The flow and mechanic properties of this fault will be very different. When the sediment affected by the fault movement is only partially lithified, then the grains will tend to slide with respect to each other, forming a deformation band. Grains become a backup packed, and some of them might break, resulting in a decreased porosity of the rock. When the rock is fully lithified and has a massive behavior, things are very different. Some faults can be very sharp, with deformation strictly confined to the fault plane. Other faults can be tens of meters thick and develop fault zones. In fault zones, we define a damage zone characterized by a large number of fractures with little displacement. We define a fault gouge, where rock fragments have variable dimensions and sorting is very poor, and the sharp fault plane. The damage zone is typically has high permeability, whereas the fine-grained gouge is often a barrier to fluid. Predicting properties of subsurface faults, even when imaged by seismics, is a great challenge. Here, you find a few general points you need to remember on faults. Following the stage of elastic loading, mechanical instabilities will arise and the body might break, forming a fault. Faults are zones of high deformation, separating blocks of undeformed material. Faults accommodate large deformations. Faults have variable structures, resulting in variable physical properties.